It's fantastic to be making RuneScape content for you all again. I'm very glad to be able to share my accolades and my rather painfully slow and tedious grinds with you. In this video, we'll be diving into the entirety of my Chunkman's account and giving once and for all an in-depth and understandable list of what we've accomplished, what goals we've had, and what rule set I follow to reach where we are today. Long, long ago, in the distant year of 2022, yes, it's only been 2 years now, in the beginning of March, I got an idea. Snowflake Iron Man accounts are cool. I want to play a Snowflake account. Let's see. I've already got a Bronze Man Defense Pure that doesn't seem to be doing much, so maybe not that. I could do a Tile Man. Oh, I know! A Chunk Locked account! It's like a Region Locked account, except with even more insane grinds, and sometimes more content. Plus, there's two types of it. Some people do an extreme version of it and go for the highest level goals, which almost always maxes your account before you leave a few areas. Although, I don't know if I'm able to commit myself to something that intense, but I don't mind a bit of intensity, so maybe the other version, where I only need to be able to do the lowest level requirement of the highest task. For instance, I could smelt a rune bar, rather than getting 99 smithing to make a rune scimitar, would be better and have more content, plus still some very intense grinds. Now, don't let me confuse you here, I love my Chunk account, I love the region locked experience, however, I'm a RuneScape player, and as a lot of us know, we love to crap on the game we love. That aside, I just wanted to clear up the differences between my style of Chunk account versus an extreme chunker. Also a term you will probably hear me use a lot, and other people who make Chunk content is a chunker. That is, a player who has a Chunk account. We are chunkers. We are mighty. Okay, I know. Get on with the gameplay and the rules, not the conceptualization between your account and a different account, and I promise, soon I will. But there's still a tiny bit of difference to still clear up between Chunk accounts, because my Chunk account takes it to a whole new level of debauchery. Rather than other Chunk accounts that will start in, say, Lumbridge, or choose a random chunk to start in, I chose 10 very specific chunks where I have to go in a random order. And when I set up my region locking experience, why did I select 10 very specific chunks? Why haven't I continued to mention that I use the term debauchery? Well, I think it's time for me to explain that. Anyone who's trained agility in the barbarian outpost or just wanted their vials to smash when their potions depleted know. You need to complete Alfred Grimhand's Barcrawl, a normally very quick and minute side quest where you visit 9 different bars, get 9 different alcoholic beverages, and return to the barbarian outpost after with a signed card from the bartenders. As a quick aside, you might wonder why that would be what I chose. I thought it would be pretty cool to roleplay as a barbarian, who got kicked out of barbarian village and has to come back and prove that he's a real barbarian now with a signed Barcrawl card. As well as possibly completing some barbarian tasks at the end after his Barcrawl card is finished, maybe or maybe not. Back to the Barcrawl, if you're asking yourself why is that something you have to do to be able to smash vials or use an agility course, I don't blame you. But all of those chunks for the Barcrawl have a lot of unique content, grinds associated with them, and items that you can collect that I thought it would be a cool enough idea, and still do. Don't you doubters try to doubt me. Now, let's talk about some of the account's restrictions. I can't revisit a chunk unless it has a means of direct teleportation, or I have the means to directly unlock its teleportation, such as I get a spirit seed and I'm able to put one in my player own house, and then I get a second one and I'm able to put it in the chunk of Port Sarim, which has a spirit tree. Then I would be able to go back to Port Sarim in that instance, even though previously I wasn't able to get directly back into it. Another case where this is semi-important is the Lumberyard chunk. I can't normally get back there, but if I complete a clue and got a Lumberyard teleport scroll, I could go back to the Lumberyard and possibly even make some planks. Other than in that example, though, I can use things like teleports, jewelry, or any other method that directly enters me into the chunk. If that is a minigame teleport, once the bar crawl is completed, those will start to unlock other chunks. However, there is one type of chunk we will be unlocking before any chunk that isn't associated with it, and those are chunks that contain bars. If I have the way to get to a chunk that has a bar, doesn't matter if it's connected directly to my chunk or not, but unless it's, say, unlocked behind Mauritania and I don't have Priest in Peril done, I can go to it. Unless, obviously, I can't currently. And once I can, it will immediately be on the list for the next available chunks. The next restriction to mention is interaction with enemies, items, or anything outside of the chunk. If it is in my line of sight, and I'm able to interact with it without being pulled outside of the chunk, I can interact with it. For instance, if I attack a highwayman, and he either comes to the chunk I'm in, or he dies right outside of it, I can use telegrab if the items are right outside of it, or I can just kill him and collect his items because he is in the chunk. The main goal is for me to be able to push the objects inside of my chunk and the direct right next to it outside as far as physically possible with my restrictions. So please don't call it a cop-out. Also, this will have to do as well with things outside of my chunks. Music tracks are normally the way most chunkmen show their validity as a chunkman, to say you haven't gone completely onto the other side of the map and all of your music tracks are there. If I have to go between chunks, I make a line and I follow that line, and I try to follow that line every single time so that the only music tracks I've unlocked are the ones I've had to already unlock just to get to the other chunk. Yes, my account is forever tainted. I'll never get those music tracks back. Do I care? No, man. That's more music to listen to when on mobile. And sometimes you gotta listen to Sea Shanty 2 or Vision. Also, I should mention, I care more about the music tracks being unlocked than I do a diary task being broken to teleport into the chunk. Like, for instance, Sears Village. When I returned there, the way to keep my account as integral as possible with making the least changes to it was just to take the bomb of using the teleport spell. That got me one extra music track and the diary done. That one step in it. It did nothing else for me. I'm not going to be able to claim that diary until I have that chunk anyway, and I don't plan on trying to do anything like that. Just wanted to add. And I'm sorry if you can't believe that I'm gonna respect the chunk account, then there's no point in watching this video. I have followed my rules as much as I physically can. As I said, if I have to travel between a chunk when I unlock a new chunk, then I have to break them. But otherwise, I'm in those chunks, baby! I like it! It's fun! It is one of the most ridiculous restrictions and challenges I've ever put on myself in any kind of game. But it has brought so much love and life again to RuneScape for me. Now, I'm going to talk about the restriction of the chunks themselves. I will always try to accomplish every single goal inside of my chunk. In some cases, I will have an exception or I will backlog it till it's a reasonable grind. For instance, there's a point when I had Sears Village and I needed to make a U shield, because it was my best in slot shield, but I only had access to with an iron axe, so I waited until I could get a steel axe. Anyway, it happened to be the next chunk, so it didn't really matter, but I backlogged it until it was a reasonable grind for the sake of content purposes. This one, you can call a cop-out. I know people like Limpwort have committed themselves to insane, absolutely unfathomable grinds of epic proportions, and Verf as well, but then they just go and they tackle it and they finish it like it's nothing. I'm sadly not on that level, I don't think, but I'm trying my best to get there. And who knows, maybe the next account I do, I don't give myself a single exception or backlogging option in no matter what type of thing it is. I don't think it will be a chunk account, but either way, who knows. Okay, Moose, you're getting off track. Let's focus here. Back to the chunks. So, when I'm completing goals inside of my chunks, the drop rate for items on my account started at a 1 out of 100 rarity for any item that would constitute a grind. For instance, being able to smelt something with a ore drop or a bar drop rather than mining it from a rock could create a grind. And iron bars are, as an example, dropped at a 1 out of 20 rate and would start a smithing grind. And unique drops, or collection log items, as long as they're under 1 out of 1,000, in the exception of pets, if it is a pet drop from a boss or a activity other than a skilling pet, I will go for it. I have had no pets on any account ever in my history of RuneScape, and I intend to change that. I want to be able to get not a probably full Pokédex, as some people call it, but at least an adequate amount of pets, and something I'm able to look back on in the future with great pride. If I think the pet is absolute hogwash, I may skip the pet. I'll be brutally honest with you. I'm not trying to get a Pokédex. It's just a pride thing. Another good way to think of if I think it's going to be hogwash is if I think the amount of times I have to kill the pet will put me close to the drop rate for the pet to complete tasks inside the chunk anyway, then I'll probably go for that pet. If not, I probably will skip it up so that I can move on to the next chunk and come back when I'm stronger and more able to get that pet. Okay. I think that finally about does it for the restrictions. But here's the question. What happens if I break them? Will I delete my account and restart, of course? No, screw that. I'm only joking. Please note, that's a joke. It's not real. It is a joke. This is a self-imposed rule set, and I won't be upset if I do make the occasional mistake. They're only natural in the path of learning and growth. Now, I beg of you, please don't click off yet. I know this is a ton of talking and not much doing, but we still have a little more to go over. My account has a few long-term, absolutely essential goals from its very start. Once I complete the bar crawl, I have to start tackling the barbarian outpost chunk itself and all that that entails, from armor to fremenic drops and crates to fishing, and last but not least, getting the penance queen pet, so that I may be able to look out over the barbarians and say that I truly am one of them now. Once this is done, my account officially chooses its next chunks like all others, you know, except for the fact that I have to do every bar first. But, you know, other than that, it'll become a normal Chunkman account afterwards. Okay, finally, let's get into it.
Episode 1, The Birth of the Barbarian.
Very beginning of the very first episode, I started my adventure by getting kicked out of the barbarian outpost and woke up battered, bruised, and alone in the top of the Blue Moon Inn in Varrock. We had nothing except some tools and other oddities from that tutorial land that we got to go on a field trip to when we were a child. Luckily, the bank has no monthly fees, so they kept everything for me all these years free of charge. With some pep in our step, we checked out the town and saw what we could and picked up everything that was to be picked up and not nailed to the ground. Plus, we went to the museum and we helped and fixed the exhibits that got us 9 Slayer and Hunter. However, afterwards, I had to quickly set my eyes back on the Blue Moon Inn. Before we could purchase a drink from that bartender, he told me,
"You must train your skills and accomplish all that you can within the confines of this land before you want me to sign that card and sell you my drink."
I thought, that's a little strange and coincidental, but oh well. I searched and I found that they were as follows. I needed to train my magic to level 62 so I could cast Wind Wave. I needed to get level 75 thieving, for in the future, I had a premonition at the gypsy that I would need to thieve a gnome. And I had no way to return here if I was at the gnome land. I needed to get level 13 cooking to make a beautiful dish of scrambled eggs. I needed to fletch to 27 for an awesome oak shield. And finally, I needed some combats to upgrade myself and make myself stronger. I needed level 20 defense for mithril armor, level 30 attack for adamant weaponry, and level 30 range for a maple shortbow with adamant arrows. Now that we were about to start all of this, we realized we needed money, and we needed to find a way to fuel our depraved and drunken adventure we were about to start. We did the only logical things one such as ourselves could do: rob every single person we could until we were on the brink of death, then chop down city trees and extort the local merchant to buy the logs for gold, and if they wouldn't pay a reasonable amount, we would burn the logs in the city streets and watch them burn, forever scorching those cobblestones. Then we saved the ashes as a memento of what we'd done. Thus concluded a day's work. For all you RuneScape players out there who aren't looking for the story part, we trained thieving to 12, woodcutting to 18, and firemaking to 15 on the first episode.
Episode 2, The Cabbage Fueled Nightmare.
Nightmare, nightmare, nightmare!
Now that I was in Varrock proper, it's time to really learn every single bit I could about it, and dominate it. I learned about an infinite food source that I could make use of for the price of 1 gold per food. I could either buy cabbages from the cook in the kitchen at the Blue Moon Inn, or beer from the bartender. I didn't know it yet, but had it not been for these two food options, this account may not even be possible for me, since my only other food option was killing imps in hopes for their raw food / cooked food drops. Don't worry, we killed a lot of imps anyway. Beginner clues suddenly entered my view as a source of some of the best in slot items in possible fashion. Easy clues were also on the table, but much less doable at the moment, especially when all I have is this one count. Sadly, my attempts at clues didn't go very well. I ended up completing one, then I got another, which I did, but the step had me go outside the chunk, and I did it. Why? Because I thought maybe doing clues outside of my chunk would be a cool exception to the account, but I immediately felt it was against the point and dropped all the items from the clue, and before you asked, I opened it and then felt the stupidity of my actions immediately as I opened it. I should have just dropped the casket, because honestly, it was foolish. Anyway, that aside, we're moving on to the training dummies in the little medieval gym north of the East Varrock Bank. Anyway, they're a great way to get early combats to start an account, and I chose to hit them once with each attack style, then ignore them for good, because I didn't want to get those free levels. I was just going to struggle and kill the dang men and women and whatever else I could kill inside of Varrock. Now, I know I said my plan is men and women there, but the first few actual kills on the account were using a crossbow against muggers south of the bank in an area that they couldn't reach me, which happened to be that old man's house for the Daddy's Home quest. I would move between this space and a house that I called the Man House, because it has two men in it, all the time. That's their spawn. It's great for my account, great little training room, but when my health would regen from using the safe spot, I would run back in, pickpocket them, and then run back out and kill a few muggers. When this account started, it was a hardcore Iron Man. It was more just to see how far I'd get. I ended up thieving one too many times, and I just straight up lost the hardcore status. Almost immediately, I'll be completely honest with you. Nonetheless, of the early death, we got training done, and we went all the way up to 35 range, and then we moved on to the melee styles once we had a little bit more hit points from the XP we got while training. Strength was leveled to 30, defense was leveled to 20, and attack got all the way to level 13. hit points had also increased all the way to 31 by this point, and we'd even gotten 20 prayer from burying bones. On the non-combat side of things, we managed to get to 37 woodcutting, 32 thieving of 75, 27 fletching, and we had gotten some raw food drops, which gave us 2 cooking. Also, random events has given us 7 fishing from Bob the Cat. And we also got our frog clothing at this point. And we will eventually get the mask as well, since both of them are claimable inside of the rock.
Episode 3, Baby Demon Slayer. Slayer of gnomes? No, not yet.
Let me be 100% clear, on episode 3 there was no babies harmed in this video, but imps were harmed, and I mean exactly 1,000 imps were harmed in the making of this video. Also, 1,500 men were slain, and 1,500 fellow barbarians, specifically that one woman barbarian inside of the Blue Moon Inn, were slain. And oddly, only 325 of the normal women were slain, but you know what? I defeated enough of that barbarian, I think it equals out. I'll get right to the point about this episode, because we were now out of the account's extreme early game and into its early mid game. Our tasks to be able to purchase beer before leaving Varrock were now getting realistically closer, and soon we wouldn't have to keep staring at only Varrock all day every day. By the end of our episode, our stats were as follows. Level 33 attack, level 48 strength, still level 20 defense, level 41 range, level 37 prayer now, level 49 magic, level 46 hit points, level 56 fletching. I overfletched when regenerating HP because purchasing cabbages was slow and I needed AFK tasks to fill my time while editing. And we got 61 woodcutting as a result of that as well. We also managed to get 2 smithing from copper and tin drops, because men and women drop copper, and that one barbarian drops tin at a 1 out of 128 rate, but it does drop tin. From random events, we managed to get a bunch of levels as well. And anybody familiar with restricted accounts knows the first thing that your lamps and your books goes into is Hunter until you can catch baby implings. We managed to get all the way to level 13 in episode 3, and everybody's favorite event, Evil Bob, had given us 15 fishing at this point. As progress in this episode goes, it's kind of ridiculous. I remembered staying up late into the night just for the joy of getting out of a rock. I would get 6-hour logged multiple times a day and just log back in, happy to keep going and excited to finish these grinds. And unhealthy living habits aside, we were getting really close to seeing those new items and new places and new NPCs. And that is what was driving me, and still does. Anyway, let's get on to episode 4.
Episode 4, The Sweet Smell of Freshly Baked Batas.
I do love the smell of cooking in the morning.
It took me 4 episodes at this point, which, let's be real, looking back, I probably could have condensed it all into 2, but there's extra potato quality screenshots of my webcam for the community floating around, I guess. But we'd done it. We'd completed all the tasks I had before me, all the chunk tasks that I could possibly do. I walked my character into the bar and purchased myself my lovely beverage. Then I was on my way to the next bar, which happened to be Moose Point. I had very little to do here, but I was able to catch and cook some anchovies, and then got my drink on to move to my next chunk, which was Brimhaven. Brimhaven had a lot to offer for us. For starters, the enemies here have some cosmetic drops and other fun things like eye patches and iron bars. However, that's a small fry compared to the new skill we unlocked, which was agility. Training at the inside of the agility arena in Brimhaven from level 1 was pure hell, but it got much, much better as time went on. And believe it or not, that was all that episode 4 contained. It's time to move on to episode 5.
Episode 5, Adventures with Brimhaven, Losing a Hand.
Episode 5 kicked off with us wrapping up our agility grind. I decided to do it all off camera because it had no entertainment value. We ended up getting level 40, and it gave us the ability to purchase the pirate's hook from the amount of tickets we had collected. Afterwards, we moved on to get a drink of the chunk, and we were off to the chunk picker. Port Sarim was our next unlock, and our first official way to train farming. No, I didn't attempt to grow a spirit tree right now. That's one of those tasks I backlogged, and that would have taken years of raking the patch to get that level. We also gained a way to properly train cooking with a food shop, and we finally got access to Willow Logs. Port Sarim was a nice and quick chunk, kind of like Moosa Point, so let's move on to the drink, and then the next chunk. Wildly enough, we're still in Episode 5, and have now unlocked Sears Village as our next chunk. This makes us have to go back to either A, Varrock to use the rooftop course, or B, Brimhaven, Agility, again. Needless to say, I had had about enough of that lava-filled cave, deadly obstacles and traps for a while, and I went to Varrock. This isn't a long-term issue for the account, since travel between Varrock is doable with teleports, whereas at this point in time we had no direct way to travel back to Brimhaven. I did choose to teleport back to Sears Village once I got the 50 agility to use the Sears Village rooftop, but this broke the hard diary task that I had aforementioned. So long as I don't claim those diary rewards, though, that's fine to me. However, doing the Varrock rooftop course until 50 agility wraps up episode 5.
Episode 6. Real estate has really been purchased.
Yeah, for real, bro. No lie, no cap.
I mentioned we unlocked Sears Village just now, which means we were also able to purchase our first home and do absolutely nothing inside of it, nor go to it, because we would have to teleport outside of Sears Village when returning again via the teleport. But we also have access to vials via water elementals of all things underneath of the elemental workshop dungeon. It happens to have quite a few random unique enemies for us to kill with cool drops associated with them, but none of them are upgrades or best in slot or even cosmetic. They're more just secondary for other skills, which are very far away. Drops aside, they also made some pretty great enemies for us to kill. The prayer altar just directly south of us was great for zero supply training. We got all the way to 36 attack, 48 strength, and 40 defense, which was the only combat goal, so we could wield a U shield, but we got the others up as well, because may as well get some more of those drops that we could use way down the line. And that is a nice little extra boost to our stats as well. Now hopefully you just caught that I was talking about a U shield, and for those of you who know how to get a U-Shield, you know that that means two things. I need to get 60 woodcutting to get multiple U's, and I need to get 72 fletching to make a U-Shield. And I need 60 fire making to burn a U-Log, because there's U-Trees. Freaking U-Logs, man. So much work for a silly log.
Foreshadowing magic logs win?
Anyway, time for some grinds.
We'll be right back.
episode 7. My hand got legit 100% for real fucked up.
Alright, so I know I said 72 fletching was a grind like 30 seconds ago, but for the sake of my sanity and the account's progression at that point, and don't worry, I forget about both these things down the line, fall into a deep pit of year-long grinds, I backlogged the fletching grind until I got a better axe. So with that said, we've completed every other chunk challenge by getting 60 firemaking to be able to light a U log, and we have the logs to be able to make a U shield down the line, and we used the rooftop course. Those were the only tasks for Sears Village, and it's time to go and get a drink on once more, and then head back to the chunk picker. Once we finished rolling, we ended up getting the gnome stronghold, so I want to clarify. The original reason I trained up my thieving so far in Varrock was because I was going to do the chunks in order of the bar card. Then I decided to change that up and use the chunk picker's random option to roll at random, because that's a lot more exciting and a lot more fun. This is also why, up until now, I hadn't mentioned anything about that thieving grind from our first chunk. We only ended up getting 40 at the end for guards, but we went a little past it for GP though. So technically, the first backlog wasn't actually the fletching grind. So, we have to return to Varrock once more and train on men or guards till 75 thieving. Flash forward a few weeks or so, and we got it done. So back to the gnome land. Inside of the gnome stronghold, there was a few other grinds, including an other 70 plus skill requirement for me.
The return of the Yule log!
Yes, that's right! I've gotten an axe upgrade, all the way from iron to steel! Yeah, baby! So I can cut oaks inside of the gnome stronghold for about 2 months, rather than have just been patient in Sears Village and done it in under one. This grind was pretty terrible, but it gave me a lot of time to work on myself and my mental well-being, so that's always a plus. It was also in the process of this video being made and edited, I had murked up my thumb on my dominant hand really frickin' bad. I spent the majority of the process working left-handed, so for anyone watching these videos retrospectively, the editing on this episode was a real stinker, and I truly apologize. Like, I did what I could. It was not the best. At least these days, I do have full use of my thumb again on that hand. I just had a really bad infection from an animal bite, and I had to keep it, like, clean and do what I could and follow the medical guide. Sorry for the gross thumb story there. Back to the Chunkman account. Back to the Chunkman! Episode 8, My Life as a Gnome. I wake up. I inhale the musty scent of sap from the grand tree, mixing with the various delicacies of gnome cuisine. I climb down the tree's many floors until I see its massive doors at the ground. I push them open. Then I proceed to run right to the nearest oak tree and start cutting that bad boy down. We gotta get 72 fletching somehow, and I'm gonna go frickin' insane otherwise. I do have other grinds to accomplish in this chunk, and I wanna be clear. It's not all always woodcutting and fletching, because now I've gotten 17 hunter from a mix of the first levels having been gained in the Museum of Varrock, and many lamp/books from random events. And yes, this was all before the random event update that gave you more lamps. For anybody unfamiliar with what 17 Hunter unlocks, that unlocks the ability to catch baby implings with the use of a butterfly net, which means you can then teleport to Puro Puro, which it just so happens there is a wheat field that spawns the Puro Puro portal inside of the gnome stronghold. With having Puro Puro unlocked, in a more broader term, it also means we have an impling grind unlocked. Oh lord, here we go. Death of the Chunk Band has started. I can hear you saying it now. So many chunk accounts, been so long in Puro Puro. But it gives you a ton of resources, so I'm not very upset, and I'm not going for lucky imps. The only imp that I'm going for level-wise is an Eclectic at level 50 Hunter. They are the highest always spawning impling in Puro Puro, and what I mean by that is there will always be Eclectic spawning from set points. Anything higher than it doesn't have a set point, and it is completely random. So those implings are off the table for grinds. After a total of 4,000 implings of various types before Eclectics caught, we hit 50 Hunter. From that, we were able to now catch Eclectics, get some best-in-slot upgrades to skilling, such as a Rune Dagger and Red Spiky Vambraces, as well as the ability to get a lot of gold bars and oak planks, which will be useful down the line. But that does end the chunk task for Hunter. The other content in episode 8 was just a lot of fletching. We had now managed to get up to level 65 out of 72, still had a lot of oak trees to cut, and a lot of oak longbows to make, but we would get there someday. With that though, that finishes episode 8, so now let's move on to episode 9.
Episode 9, A Brief Gnome Genocide.
Alright, so I said that we were going to move on to episode 9, but truth be told, all that really happened was mass casualties in the gnome community and their military forces. Gnome guards, gnome women, gnome children, gnome men, nobody was safe. Even the terror birds and the terror bird riders. None of them. They all got what was coming to them, which happened to be me training all the way to 60 range to be able to use U equipment, and then I also trained all the way to 40 attack for Runite. But that wasn't all in the episode. No. I also did a really long bank tour. Then I spent like 5 more minutes going over the chunk task we still needed to do. So I'm going to skip back to the main focus of the grinds and skip right on to the next episode, because that's just content from the past.
Episode 10.
Can I, get a Big Mac, large fries, and a number 9, two more number 9s, and a large Coke? Alright everybody, I think it's time I was really honest with you. I used to run a really poopy PC setup, but it was still good enough, that I don't really need to complain. I was convinced, though, that I could no longer play RuneScape, either multiple accounts or just one at a time, because my computer was shitting the bed on me every time I tried. After various troubleshooting and driver updates, nothing changed in RuneScape. Fast forward like 3 weeks later, and that shit worked fine with zero issues. Like, dude, excuse me? What the hell? Anyways, finally managed to get back to the grinds, and I started on a magic one. I need to be able to cast Vulnerability, which requires level 66 magic, and some soul runes from Essence Implings. So I got to work using every rune I had, plus many, many more that I had to catch from just Essence Implings inside of Puro Puro or wandering around in the Gnome Stronghold. So many, I got to level 52 Hunter just off those Essence Implings. This was honestly a really fun grind. I always love training combat and watching the numbers get bigger and the spells look cooler and everything start that snowball of progression. Now that we're officially 2/3 of a really spooky number in magic levels, we can move on to the next task.
I get a little service over here. A little bit of Mac on my fries. Just want some snacks on my time. Maybe a little lunch service. Come on, baby, please don't cry. I just wanna have some fries. Come on, over. Let me tell you how much I wanna eat. I want a 55 and a 73. Then I bring it on home and I eat it all up. Gotta get to the washroom and I dip in the tub. Oh yeah, let the bubbles flow. Oh yeah, eating with my toes. Oh yeah, it's so divine. Oh yeah, no smell for mine. Oh, you wanna eat my friends? No, these are my burgers, man. Ain't no way, get off my high horse, man. Please don't touch my fries. Please don't touch my guys. People say I make some stank when I'm cooking it with my thang. But I tell them it ain't no deal, cause I got a special on the number deals. Every time I go on in, they say, whoa, brother, are you really him? I say, yes, that's me, and I got the notes. Everybody tells them I got the recipes. Yo!
Hopefully everybody enjoyed that. Not my beat, but some time into it for y'all, and I'll upload it on its standalone as well. Now, as hopefully I made a nice little editing video there of me cooking a bunch of pineapple pizzas, I ended up cooking over 1,000, and we got 65 cooking. Originally, I was going to have a gnome cooking requirement, but it turns out I could do no gnome cooking deliveries, so what I ended up doing was just making a ton of pineapple pizzas and banking them so I had a bunch of food for future chunks. With doing this, I made my own task and considered it completed. After finishing up with the pizzas, I went back to fletching and I got level 72, which allowed me to have my U shortbow, U longbow, U stock, but last, but certainly not least, the level I needed it for, the U shield. This gave me a whopping +1 across all defensive stats from my shield slot, which used to be a maple shield. And I got 77 wood cutting in the process. So, I call that a win-win. I don't know about you. Now, we only had one more task left to leave the chunk. And the level requirement for it we already had. That was the thieving requirement that we needed. So what I did, I pickpocketed the gnomes until I had at least one of every of its unique drops, including a fire orb. Then following that, we moved on to Blurberry's bar, purchased ourselves another fine beverage, got really hammered, blacked out, and then next thing I knew, I had woken up in Western Yunil. This chunk has very few requirements, but I'll get into them shortly, seeing as they aren't per se short requirements. There's just not many of them. And that concludes what episode 10 was. Episode 11. Time to get ourselves a bone or two, specifically one that's long and one that's curved, and then we can get super drunk and leave these ogres behind. Behind, I tell you. I swear there is no time I would ever possibly foreshadow wanting to go back to the ogres. No. Why would I do that? How could I even do that? Could I really train all the way to 50 construction and then teleport outside my house if I moved it to Yunil? No. Why? That would be so extra. Why would I possibly want to do that? Back to episode 11, though, and not what could be episode 13. It took me 3,625 ogres exactly to get a curved bone. In that grind, I also got 8 long bones and a ton of ranged XP, putting us all the way to 74 range and 51 prayer from the big bones. The reason we got so much ranged XP specifically is because I brought as much ammunition as I could before we left our chunk, so we could hopefully not have to flinch ogres to get a curved bone for 5 days. Don't worry, we also killed every other unique NPC that we could, a minimum of 5 times. I also explored any last crevices before getting my drink on. So I went into the bar, purchased it, and then I was faced with the Wheel of Destiny once again. I had a glaring 1 out of 3 chance that I have to grind for a pet, and a 2 out of 3 chance that I grind to train a little bit more before I have to do that. I ended up hitting the 2 out of 3 and going to Ardoin. This presented me a fair bit of training from enemies inside the castles, streets, and zoo, to a collection log slot, a giant's key from hill giants, and another potential bit of thieving available if done with some very scuzzy tactics. Disclaimer, I could have pushed a hero all the way into my chunk from the RD center and trained to 80 thieving to pickpocket them. Honestly, this wouldn't have been the worst thing ever to do. Hell, historically for my account, I've had to use my main to splash on guards and Varrock to train without being pulled out of my chunk, and I was okay with that. This was a few steps past that and involved dragon spearing with possibly 2 accounts to perfectly get the NPC inside of where I could interact with him, and that's a whole convoluted mess of gray areas and possibly breaking the account rules. This being said, my rule of thumb is, if it can work, I can do it. So if I ever have a way back to the Western East Ardoin chunk, I will push him in and steal all his crap. Disclaimer over. Okay, ignore all that BS about the hero for a bit. Let's focus on what I actually need to get done to leave this chunk. Firstly, I can get an epic Amulet of Lucian for some Fashionscape bonuses and quest progression. Secondly, I do have a useful thieving method still available to me anyways. I can thieve the upstairs of a few houses in Ardoin and collect nature runes or coins, and you better know I got a crap ton of nature runes. Okay, maybe not a crap ton, I got 250, but that's 1 nature rune per chest, so that's 250 interactions. And don't worry, those baby numbers like 250 don't faze me anymore. But this did end up taking a few hours still, so it was a fun little grind. I was able to knock out a few diary tasks as well, minus the hero one, and kill my needed 5 slays of all NPCs. Then when this was done, I was able to head over to the bar. So we arrived in the bar, and I purchased my beverage. My mind shook for a moment, my vision blurred, and then I saw the chunk picker before me again. I rolled, and lo and behold, I got the lumberyard. I was able to pick up a saw, which unlocks construction for me when I leave the chunk, a skill I was initially scared of because I thought it might be hard to train on my account, but then I realized, if there is a will, there is a way, and I will train construction. Although, construction is a free skill for my account, there are no grinds associated with it in my account, namely because I do not feel that it is very barbarian to have a polished home. I can train construction for personal reasons, but I don't need to worry about it for chunk reasons. To be blunt, the chances of Moose's bar ever having a construction cape are not zero, but extremely close to it. Maybe in the future, when I get mahogany homes as a doable task, we'll look at assigning a chunk task or two from mahogany homes, but the skill of construction itself does not add tasks for me. The second to last drink, however, was purchased, because all I had to do while I was in the lumberyard was make sure I picked up a saw, turned a single piece of wood into a plank, and then killed every NPC 5 times. I did that, and then we went into the bar, talked to the barkeep, and purchased our penultimate beverage. After receiving the beverage in our hand, we chugged it down as fast as we could. My mind was nearly obliterated at this point from all the different liquors, spirits, and tonics, but I pushed on. I stared Destiny straight in the face and laughed, for I knew my fate. I had seen it in a dream.
Paladon has arrived! Just like that, I have arrived from a magic spell straight into the center of the town's northern square. And now I realize the shoes I needed to fill, for I could hear the great clawing from underground. I could see the walls of white with warriors clad in incandescent armor of the gods. Somewhere in my mind, I saw visions of myself becoming accepted by them and their crest, but to earn the gods' favor would be no easy task. Let's start with getting a lay of the land and understanding what I have before me. I have a bank, a sweet bank. How I've wished to unload all my seeds from ogres, my weapons, my bones, and more. After unloading my massive sack, I went to check on my ways of building myself a slightly better home. Not too civilized, but a little useful, and I was struck with the horrid realization that I would have to kill hundreds, no, thousands of those knights that I sought to join because they had iron bars on them which I could construct exit portals to my home with. Alright, for those of you who aren't really here for the story and more just want the simpler what's going on stuff, I had no idea what decided to make me do this, but I wanted to get any pet that I could that was from a boss that was under a 1 out of 4,000 drop chance. But here we are, and here I still am to this day without a baby mole pet, so we'll see how that goes in a year or two. And fighting the giant mole has been, well, a time. I get constantly crash and lose kills often a few hits before I would have gotten the kill. I have no form of energy potion other than strange fruit, so 90% of the kills is spent walking around from her den to catch up to her or find her. However, recently I got my main to be able to use the Falador hard diary, so at least I can spend a little less time looking for the mole each time on the Chunkman. This sped my kills up to about 15 to 20 minutes rather than 20 to 30 plus minutes per kill. I also didn't hit very hard at all for a very long time, so up until recently, my DPS to deal with the mole was absolute garbage on top of everything else. I ground my combat stats and my ranged all to 65 at a minimum and 80 for ranged, and now I can kill the giant mole in about 7 to 15 minutes rather than 15 to 20. So it's pretty big in total grind save. So other than attempting to get the giant mole pet, I also have to get 70 prayer inside the chunk so that I can complete a Falador diary task. I should be able to complete this hopefully before the giant mole is dealt with. If not, I'll probably just put as many of my lamps that I get from now on into trying to finish up 70 prayer. At the time of recording this, I am currently 60 prayer, so that's another 10 levels, and a lot of normal or big bones to kill and bury. There was also a few other Falador diary tasks to complete, as well as some best in slot items to get, such as a rune med helm from the giant mole, a steel kite shield from smithing it, an adamant mace from the shop, and an amulet of strength from the mole. The reason I set a steel kite shield from smithing it is because the giant mole drops 100 noted iron ore pretty frequently, enough so that a smithing grind is now on the table. The total level we need to get for smithing is 50 to be able to smith a mithril dagger. Since my arrival into Falador, content has been retroactively added to one of my chunks. This is the first instance of this, but if this does happen again, I'm going to do the same thing I did now, which was go back to that chunk before I continue with the current chunk and finish those grinds. What this meant for my account was when Forestry came out, I waited until Part 2 came out so that I only had to go there once, or a maximum of twice, whatever's needed to complete the log, and then I green-logged as much of the Forester's collection log as I can, including the pheasant egg and the Forester's boots, the lumberjack boots, felling axe handle, as well as all other tools. If that bit about Forestry caught you off guard, don't worry. Forestry as a whole kind of caught me off guard too, but I want to make sure I can do as much as I can with the chunks that I have. Now, after Forestry was done, I returned to Falador, and that is where we have been.
since before forestry and after it, I was lamping all of my lamps into crafting until I could get 5 and make as many gold rings as I could get my hands on, because I only had that one mold at this time unless I wanted to train a bunch of construction with just iron bars, or the possibility of oak planks from passing implings. So, I got level 20 crafting for sapphires, which I can buy of the uncut variety in Falador to further train it to the goal of making a battle staff with a fire orb that I got from pickpocketing that gnome a while ago. I have now killed over 7,000 white knights, 10,000 men, 2,000 imps, and multiple thousands of chickens, and so on, all in the attempt to hit better at mole, and it has helped tremendously. We're getting kills so fast, and I feel like one of these days we will pull the pet. And then once we do, we just have to finish up the 70 prayer grind, and it'll be off to another pet grind at Barbarian Assault. Although, even after the pet and 70 prayer, there was one more goal. Level 15 farming, because we have a tree patch, and we can rake our tree patch up to level 15 and plant an oak. Due to our rule set, that's all we needed to do. We are going to push this as far as we can with the seeds we have until we are done with Falador. So hopefully, we get pretty high up there in the farming skill and get some free levels, and some extra good logs. Farming, prayer, mole, forestry aside, that's where we're at today. The account, in its combat stats, is rocking 65 attack, 70 strength, 65 defense, 80 ranged, and 69 magic, getting close to 70 every day. Our prayer level is 60 still. I look forward to seeing everybody in episode 12. I hope you enjoyed this summary and catch up of the journey of my account so far. This has been a big piece of pride for me. Even if just personal pride at home when I have a little extra time. But I have not given it up, I have not put it down, and I have not abandoned it. So please, I look forward to you in the next one. Atamo out. Oh yeah. Like, comment, and sub if you guys want to do that thing, because this was a really long time in the making. And I'm sure episode 12 is going to take quite a long time as well, but I currently have over 500 clips to go through, so that at least is in the works right now. All right, peace!